So we will discussing about a spectrometer grating. Here is the spectrometer and here is the grating. We'll discuss about more in detail. Here is the plan of the talk. I'll discussing about the basic phenomena of diffraction and the type of diffraction. In the type of diffraction, I will discuss about the Fraunhofer and Fresnel-Swiss diffraction. We will discussing about the grating, how we will can construct the grating, and how the diffraction phenomena occurs in the grating. In the experimental section, I will discuss about the aim, apparatus required, formula used in the experiment. I will also discuss about the spectrometer, which is the main important apparatus for this experiment. I'll discussing that how we can calculate the least count in the spectrometer and how we will take the reading during the experiment. Now we'll go to the procedure to perform the experiment, then precaution and sources of error, and then finally we will move to the reference books or reference material that will help you to understand this experiment easily. Now starting with the diffraction, as we all know that the bending of light from an edge of an obstacle is known as diffraction. Suppose, let us see this figure. This is a sharp obstacle and this is a screen. If a light enters and hit this obstacle block this light. Means we will get a geometrical shadow in the screen. But due to this edge or sharp edge, the light bent and we will get and light in the geometrical shadow, or we can say that there is an encroachment of light in the geometrical shadow, and this is known as the diffraction of light. So we can say that the diffraction of light is refers to various phenomena that occur when a wave encounters an obstacle or a slit, and it is defined as the bending of light across the corner of an obstacle or aperture into the region of geometrical shadow of obstacle. So the diffraction of light is basically of two types. We can say this is of Fraunhofer type of diffraction and Fresnel type of diffraction. First, we will discuss about the Fraunhofer type of diffraction. This type of diffraction was given by Joseph von Fraunhofer, and he is the person who gave the first time the diffraction. And in this type of diffraction, the source and the screen are at infinite distance from the obstacle. Suppose, see this figure, this is the source and this is the screen and this is the slit, and we have used here two biconvex lens, the lens 1 and lens 2, you can see. So actually this type of diffraction is not possible in the laboratory because we cannot put the light and screen at an infinite distance from the obstacle, so we use two biconvex lens to perform this type of Fraunhofer diffraction in laboratory. So this is the point source, so it will produce a cylindrical or a spherical wavelet. And if this spherical or cylindrical wavefront strikes the lens convert it into plane wavefront. And this plane wavefront interact with the slit and get deviated with an angle theta with an incident ray. And again, this biconvex lens converts these light rays into a point P, and that P point will be the point of bright or dark depending upon the condition of path difference as we know. So this is the procedure of Fraunhofer type of diffraction in which the source of light and screen are at an infinite distance from the obstacle. Now we will discuss the second type of diffraction, which is known as Fresnel type of diffraction. And this type of diffraction was given by Auguste Fresnel. And in this type of diffraction, the source and the screen are at a finite distance from the obstacle, or we can say slit. In this, see this figure. This is the source and this is the screen. Sorry, this is the screen and this is the slit. The light, again, the spore, this is the point source, so it will produce a spherical or a cylindrical wavefront, and it can interact with this or get deviated with this slit, and again it merge at a point P. This point P will be the point of a bright or will be a dark depending upon the condition of path difference. So this is the type of Fresnel type of diffraction. Sometimes students get confused that in which type of diffraction the distance is infinite and in which type of diffraction the distance is finite. So there's a simple trick to remember that we have two words. We have Fraunhofer and we have pressure. Okay. Among these two words, which one is larger or longer, we can say? Obviously, the Fraunhofer word is longer than the Fresnel word. So we can say that in which the Fraunhofer is longer means the distance between the source and the screen are at an infinite distance in case of Fraunhofer from the slit. And in case of Fresnel, that it is a shorter word, so we can say it is a finite distance. So in this case, in case of Fresnel, the source and the screen are at a finite distance from the slit. So this is a simple trick and you can easily understood that in which type of diffraction there is infinite distance and in which type of diffraction is the finite distance. So let's move the difference between in the Fraunhofer and Fresnel type of difference. Now there are some difference between them. The first difference we have already discussed that in Fraunhofer type of diffraction, the source and screen are at infinite distance from the slit, whereas in case of Fresnel, the source and screen are at finite distance from the slit. And in case of Fraunhofer, the incident wavefront on the aperture is plane because we have used the biconvex lens, and this biconvex lens convert the cylindrical or spherical wavefront into the plane wavefront. While in case of Fresnel, we don't use any biconvex lens. So in case of Fresnel, the incident wavefront on the aperture is either spherical or cylindrical. Okay. In case of Fraunhofer, the diffracted wavefront is plane because we again using the second biconvex lens. While in case of Fresnel, there is no use of we don't use any biconvex lens. So the diffracted wavefront is spherical or cylindrical. We have already discussed that in the Fraunhofer case, we have used two biconvex lens to study the diffraction in the laboratory. While in case of Fresnel, we don't use any biconvex lens or no biconvex lens are required to study the diffraction in the laboratory. In case of Fraunhofer, the mathematical treatment is easy. The mathematical treatment is easy because we have the incident wavefront in this case is plane. So these plane wavefronts are making same angle, while in case of Fresnel that there is the incident wavefront of spherical or cylindrical, so they are making different angle. So in this case, the Fresnel case, the mathematical treatment is complicated, while in case of Fraunhofer, the mathematical treatment is easy. And this Fraunhofer types of diffraction has many application in designing the optical instrument, while the Fresnel have very less application in designing the optical instruments. There is one important parameter, that of intensity parameter of Fraunhofer and Fresnel type of diffraction, that in case of Fraunhofer, we cannot, in case of Fraunhofer, we can easily differentiate the maxima and minima. But in case of Fresnel, we cannot differentiate the maxima and minima. See these figures. This one is the intensity pattern of Fraunhofer, and this is the intensity pattern of Fresnel's diffraction. In case of these are the maxima. Obviously, the maximas are the bright points. And just see this minima condition. In this case of Fraunhofer, the minima are having the zero intensity. Means the minima is a completely dark. While in case of this, see, in case of Fresnel, the minimum intensity is not zero. Means the minimum or the minima is of less bright. Means in case of Fraunhofer, the maxima is completely bright and the minima is completely dark. While in case of Fresnel, the maxima is completely bright, but the minima is less bright. So we cannot differentiate the maxima and minima in case of this Fresnel diffraction, while we can easily differentiate the intensity pattern or maxima and minima in case of Fraunhofer difference. Now we will move about towards the grating because it is the main component of our experiment. as we know that it is used for the for showing the diffraction pattern, and diffraction grating is defined as the arrangement of large number of equidistant parallel narrow slits of equal width which are separated by equal opaque portion is known as grating. A grating is a plane sheet. Basically, it is a plane sheet on which the opaque rolling are made by a fine diamond puncture. The modern commercial grating contains about 6,000 to 15,000 lines per inch, and the rolling acts as an obstacle having a definite width of B and the transparent space between the rolling acts as a slit A, and the combined width of rolling A and B is known as a grating element. Suppose this is a transparent glass sheet, and we are making in with the use of diamond pointer, we are making as a rolling in this. Okay, so this is acts as a transparent point, transparent slit, and this acts as a rolling. And this distance is transparent or slit distance is known as A, and this is known as the B. So this A plus B is known, completely known as grating element. So normally the grating are of two types, the reflection type of and transmission type of grating. Suppose if we incident a white light or white light source in the grating, it will gives us the central white light and a combination of bigger pattern in the both the side, in the left side as well as right side. And the diffraction grating was discovered by, firstly, by James Gregory. Here's a picture of the James Gregory. And the first man-made grating was made around 1785 by the inventor David. Basically, who uses the hairs between two finely threaded screws to make a diffraction grating. Now we'll discuss about the how the diffraction occurs in the grating. We will discuss about this. Suppose this the MN represents the section of a plane transmission grating, and this AB, CD, and EF are the successive slits. We already discussed that in the grating there are some successive slits and there are some rollings. So in this case, this AB, CD, and EF are represented as the successive slits which are having the width of A, while this B, C, D, E is a rolling which are of equal width of B. So this A plus B from A to C, suppose we are considering a pair from A to C, so this A to B, A plus B is known as the grating element, and it is very important term in this part. So this is known as the grating element. Now, suppose we incident a plane wave light or a plane monochromatic light in this grating element, in this grating, and it is having a lambda wavelength. So, according to the Huygens principle, each point slit as A, B, C, D, and many more acts as a secondary source, or they spread in all direction on the other side of this grating. So, let us suppose that these secondary wavelets are making an angle theta with a normal to the grating. So this is the angle theta. Now, if we are considering this and this path, obviously this path, the C to this path, and this is a biconvex lens which is used to converge the rays or the wavelets at a point, some point. So if we taking these two paths, obviously this path is shorter and this path is longer. So we can calculate the path difference by taking a normal to this point. Suppose this point is G. So this CG, if we are considering this path from A to C, you see this, this CG is the path difference, and we can easily calculate this path difference by at the path difference, this angle is theta, again this angle will be theta. So you have calculated it many times. So this will be A plus B sine theta. So this is for one pair. If we consider that there are a number of pairs, so the path difference will be same for any pair of the corresponding points, and it will be A plus B sine theta. these points get diffracted and again merge at a point P1, and that P1 point will be bright if it will satisfy the condition A plus B sine theta equal to M lambda, as we all know. And this M will be can be taken value from 0, 1, 2, 3, N. So if we are considering about the undiffracted position, suppose this yellow dotted line. So in this undiffracted position, the theta is 0. So obviously sine theta will be 0. And if we put that value here, A plus B sine theta equal to M lambda, this is 0. So M lambda equal to 0. This signifies that M equal to 0 for this case. Okay. So we can say that as the wavelet proceeding in the direction of incident rays means which are making an angle theta, means which are not diffracted, in the direction of incident rays will produce a maximum intensity at the center. So this is the maximum intensity at the center O on the screen. And this is also called as a zero order maximum or central maximum. So the center is always maximum intensity and always bright in case of diffraction grating. Now we are considering about some different angle. If we are considering about A plus B sine theta 1 equal to lambda, means we are considering some angle theta 1. So the diffracted wavelet inclined at an angle theta 1 to the incident direction. So it will give the first order maximum in the both sides of the central maximum. This is the central maximum, and again you will get the maximum from the both the sides. So these are known as the first order central maximum. Similarly, for the second order maximum, A plus B sine theta 2 equal to 2 lambda, M equal to 2 for this case, or we can say N equal to 2 for this case. So in this again, in this case again, on the either side of central maximum, this is the central maximum, different orders of secondary maxima are obtained at a point P1 and P2. These are the point P1 and these are the point P2. So first is the central maximum. Then both the side we will get the first order maximum, and again we will get the second order maximum. Normally we will observe only central maxima and the first order maxima. Secondary maxima is rarely visible. So in general we can say that A plus B sine theta equal to M lambda is the condition for maximum intensity, where M is the integer and the order of maximum intensity. If M equal to 1 is called its first order, M equal to 2 is condition for second order. And again we can write that sine theta equal to M lambda by A plus B, where A plus B is the grating element or the number of lines per unit width of the grating. Okay. Now this is a condition when we are incidenting a white light in the grating. But what happens if we incident a white light in the diffraction grating? So if we incident a white source or white light in the grating, it will consist of white central light with both sides the continuous color images. This is the center maximum, and both sides we will get the colored images. And this is because at the center all the wavelengths reinforce each other by producing a maximum intensity for all wavelengths. Hence, we will get the undispersed white image in the center. Now we'll move about the experimental part, because we will discuss about the diffraction, types of diffraction, and difference between them, and the construction of a grating, and how the diffraction process takes place in the grating. So now we'll move towards the experimental part. So our aim of the experiment is to measure the wavelength of a spectral lines of mercury source. Mercury source basically a white light source, which is by using the diffraction grating and a spectrometer. These are the apparatus required. Now we'll detailly explain the apparatus which are required for this experiment. The first one is the spectrometer, and spectrometer is used to measure the spectral components of any physical phenomena. This one is the split level, and it is a glass tube in which we have filled some alcohol or some other liquid, and it contains a air bubble, and it tells us about the if the surface is perfectly level or not. There is an air bubble. If the air bubble is in center, means the surface is leveled. But if it is not in center, so with the use of some screw, we will level it, and the bubble is in center, means the surface is level. And this is the picture of the reading lamp, and it is used to read the readings for micro or the main scale and vernier scale readings. This is the grating element. We have already talked about the grating element. This is a mercury lamp, and mercury lamp is a white light source, and it is a gas chamber lamp, gas discharge lamp, and that uses an electric arc through vaporizing mercury to produce light. This is the grating holder, which is used to mount the grating properly. And I'm telling about some important term about the grating. That normally the grating which we used in our laboratory having a 15,000 lines or rulings in the grating. So we know that 1 inch equal to 0.0254 meters. So we can calculate the number of rulings per meter on the grating as 15,000 divided by 0.0254. So by calculating, we will get that 5.9 into 10 to the 5 lines per meter, and this will be useful for calculation. Now we are discussing about the different parts of spectrometer. That it is very important for our experiment, and we divided the spectrometer in basically in three parts. The first one is called, this one is called the polarimeter. This one is called the telescope, and this one is called the prism table. Okay, the first part is polarimeter, the second part is telescope, and the middle part or the third part is called the prism table. The polarimeter consists of a slit, and this is known as polarimeter, and basically the polarimeter is fixed. We cannot move this polarimeter. And this one is the telescope. We can rotate the telescope easily. This is the focusing knob. This is the eyepiece. And these are some screws for this maintaining the telescope. This one is the telescope rotation lock screw. As I have already told you that we can rotate the telescope, but by tightening this telescope rotation lock screw, we cannot move this telescope. This is the telescope fine adjustment screw. It is used to fine adjustment for this telescope. This is the vernier table lock screw. This one is the vernier table, and we have two vernier scales. We have two scales here. One is there and one is there. So we have two scales, and this vernier table can be easily movable. But by locking this, we cannot move this vernier table. And this one is the prism table where we put the prism or grating. This one is grating holder where we put our grating easily. So this is the main components of the spectrometer which we have to understand before doing the experiment, because we have to handle each and every part of this spectrometer while doing the experiment. Now we will see how to calculate the least count of the spectrometer. As we know that least count is the minimum possible measurable value of the instrument, so we can calculate the least count of the spectrometer as the least count of the spectrometer as 1 main scale division minus 1 vernier scale division. So as I have already told you that we have two scales for in the vernier table, so the lower one is the main scale, and the upper one is called the vernier scale. Okay, and this lower one is from 0 to 360. Actually, it is not shown here, but it is a circular type of scale. So it is started from 0 degree, then 10 degree, 20 degree, 30, up to 360 degree. So it is a circular type of scale. And above this, this is a vernier scale. And in this main scale, there is from 0 to 10 scalar division. In 0 to 10 degree, there are 20 main scalar division are there. You can count them. These are 20. So from 0 to 10, there are 20 main MSD, main scalar division. From 10 to 20, again there are 20 main scalar division. So we can write that 20 main scalar division equal to 10 degree. Okay. So the value of 1 main scale division obviously 10 by 20, or we can write it half degree or 30 minutes. So the value of 1 main scale division is 30 minutes or half degree. Now we will calculate the value of 1 year scale division. As you saw that the uppermost is the 1 year scale, and there are 0 to 60 division. Okay, you are saying that this is 0 and 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. So there are 60 divisions in the 1 year scale. And the 60 division equal to 59 division of main scale. So we can write from here that we know that 1 main scale division value is, we have already calculated that half degree. So 60 1 year scale division equal to 59 multiplied by half degree. And we can, from that there, we can calculate the value of 1 year scale division, which is 59 by 60 into half degree. So this is the value of 1 year scale division. Now we will calculate the least count. I have already told you that least count is 1 main scale division minus 1 year scale division. And we have calculated the value of 1 main scale division equal to half degree or 30 minutes. And the value of 1 year scale division equal to 59 by 60 into half degree. So we can calculate the least count by taking the difference of one value of 1 main scale division to the value of 1 vernier scale division, and we will get the value of least count as half minute. So the least count of a spectrometer is half minute. Okay. Now there is a working formula which we will use for calculating the value of wavelength in the spectrometer. So this is the formula, that this formula is lambda equal to 2.54 sine theta upon small n into capital N, where lambda is the wavelength of a spectral line of different colors which we have to calculate. Theta is the diffraction angle, I have already told you about that. N is the diffraction order. Diffraction order means whether it is first order, second order, or third order. And capital N is the number of parallel lines per inch in the grating element. Okay, I have also told you about that. So this is the working formula for our experiment. Now, these are some important observations that we have already calculated that the number of rulings per meter on the grating is N equal to 5.9 into 10 to the power 5 line per meter. And the least count of the spectrometer is half minute. And normally we will calculate it for first order. We have I have written here M. You can write it N or M, any of them. So we are taking only first order. So N or M will be one here in this case. Now we'll see how to take the reading in the spectrometer. I have told you that we have the main scale, which is the lower part is the main scale, and the upper part is the 1 year scale. Okay, and it is the main scale is from 0 to 360 degree, and the 1 year is 1 year scale are having from 0 to 60 degrees. Now how we will take the main scale reading? Suppose we have this is the 1 year scale, and this having 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 60. So first we will see that the 0 coincided with which degree in the main scale. And this is 30, so obviously this one is 20. So this 1 year 0 is coinciding with the 20th degree in the main scale. So the main scale reading will be 20 degrees. Now we will see how we will take the reading for 1 year scale. I have already told you this 0 coincided with the main scale of which division? 20 degree. So main scale reading is 20 degree. And we will see that Which division of vernier scale exactly matches with the main scale? Okay, just see this. This one first division is not matches with the main scale. Again, second, third. So we'll see which division of vernier scale exactly matches with the main scale. And we'll see that this 30th division of vernier scale exactly matches with the main scale. So the vernier scale reading will be 30. And this vernier scale reading will be multiplied by the least common. So the total reading will be main scale reading plus vernier scale reading into least common. Now, I think you have understood that how we will calculate the reading. Now we'll move towards the experimental procedure. And this experimental procedure of this experiment basically divided in three parts. First part is the adjustment of the spectrometer. The second part will be the adjustment of the grating. And third part will be the actual experiment where we will take the diffraction pattern, or you'll see the diffraction pattern and take the reading. So it is the part where we have written the procedure, but I'm not going to this because I'm showing the video by which you can easily understand that how we can perform this experiment. So just see it properly. this is all about the procedure. Now we will move towards the how we will take the reading in the experiment. We have I have already told you that this is a colliometer, and here we put the source, and this is the grating, and here will be the telescope, and we will get the central maximum, and then the Wibgeur pattern from left side, and again the Wibgeur pattern to the right side. So for taking the first reading, here are two scales. One scale is here and one scale is here. So suppose here the first scale is we call V1, and the second scale is called V2. And we have to take the reading both of the vernier scales from this V1 and this V2. So suppose first we are considering the first color, then the violet color. So we move our telescope for the violet color, and as we know that there is a cross wire as a plus sign in the telescope, so we coincided this cross wire to this color, violet color slit, and then take the reading for the V1 and V2. As I already told you how to take the reading, we have to consider the main scale, then vernier scale, and then the vernier scale will be multiplied by the least count, and we will get that main scale plus vernier into least count as the total reading. So first we will move to the telescope towards the left side for the purple color, and we'll note that both V1 and V2 reading. Then we'll move this telescope towards the right side, and again we will for the violet color again, then we will move note down the V1 and V2 color reading. So by this we will take the reading. Now this is the observation table for the angle of refraction, because we have to mainly calculate the value of theta. The first is the order of a spectrum, the second one is the color of a spectrum, then the reading of a spectrum, these are the value of 2 theta and value of theta. So we can consider any of the colors which are showing bright and intense. So in this case I'm telling you about the green, yellow and red color. First we will move this telescope towards the left side, and we'll take the V1 and V2 reading, V1 vernier scale reading and V2 vernier scale reading. These all readings are in degrees. So for green color, we will move our telescope towards the green color, and we'll write the readings for V1 vernier scale and then V2 vernier scale. Similarly, we'll move this for the this telescope towards the right hand side of the green color, and again we'll write the vernier scale reading for both the V1 and V2 vernier scale. Then again we'll for yellow color we'll repeat the procedure. We will move our telescope towards the left side and right side, and we'll take the reading V1 and V2 for both the cases, for left hand side and for right side. So similarly, again for red color we'll repeat the procedure. We'll write that V1 for left hand side A, this V2 B, right hand side V1 C, and right hand side V2 D. Then we'll calculate the value of 2 theta. That we'll take as A minus C means vernier scale of both left and right side will be, we'll take the difference of them. This will give you 40.44 theta, suppose in this case. Then for this case, for second case, we'll take the B minus D means vernier 2 scale for the left hand side and vernier 2 scale for the right hand side. And this will give you some this type of values. So this is for the green color. Again, we'll calculate same using the same procedure for yellow color and red color. And then we'll calculate the mean value of this and this 2 theta. So we'll get this value. And then finally, we'll calculate the value of theta. So this is the diffraction angle for the green color. This is for yellow color, and this is for the red color. So we'll getting the value of theta with the help of this observation table. Now we have the formula that lambda equal to 2.54 sine theta upon small n into capital N. I have told you that normally in our laboratory we will use the 15,000 line point. So these are the 15,000. And we are considering only the first order, so we'll write n equal to n here, k. So the our formula becomes this much, and this is the angle of diffraction for different colors. So if we are considering the blue color, we have to write the diffraction angle for blue color. If we are considering for green color, we'll write the diffraction angle for green color, and for red color, we'll writing the diffraction angle for red color. So by calculating this type, so we will get the values of different colors wavelength. So finally, we will move towards the resolution. So we have already calculated the number of lines of the plane transmission grating are. I have already told you. Then we will write the wavelength of blue spectral lines, which by calculating this, we'll get the diffraction of the wavelength of blue spectral line. Then we'll get the diffraction of green spectral line, and we can also calculate the different types of wavelengths of different colors. So in conclusion, or then we will compare these wavelengths with the standard value of wavelength, and we can also calculate the percentage error in this case. And in conclusion, we can write that after performing the experiment, the wavelength of the spectral lines were calculated and compared with the theoretical one. And finally, we can also calculate the percentage error, and we'll write that during this experiment, we'll find that this is the percentage error during the experiment. So this is all about the experiment. And finally, the precautions and sources of error which we have to take in here during this experiment, that the first one is the grating should not be touched with the hand or should not be rubbed. It always be held by means of fingers kept to the opposite edge of the grating, and we should put the grating to the incident race, and the turntable must be labeled with the help of spirit label. And the slip should be narrow as possible, and we should do all the preliminary adjustment of the spectrometer before starting the experiment, which I have already told you that which type of adjustment we should follow. And while taking experiment, the turn table should be clamped, otherwise the reading will be changed, and the reading of for both the vernier should be taken. Okay, V1 and V2, both the vernier reading should be taken at a time. Then the sources of error, there are some sources of error also, which we should try to minimize them. The spectrometer is not properly adjusted, the first one. If the reading is not taken overhead the spectrometer, and the reading may not be taken by care of precaution. So we should take very much precaution while taking the reading. So these are some reference book from which you can read about this experiment. These are very important book. So thank you for this site, but I want to share something more. Actually, I just want to show you some practical demonstration of this diffraction grating. Can you tell me, is that visible to this chrome window is visible to everyone? Just wait. I'm just again. I'm just showing. Is that visible to you? Is that home window visible? I hope it is visible. Yeah, Aditi, are you there? Please unmute yourself. Aditi,
yes, ma'am.
Is that आपको कुछ क्रोम विंडो में कुछ दिख रहा है ना Aditi? I can't hear you.
मैं
आपको दिख रही है, विंडो दिख रही है?
हेलो
यस यस, क्रोम विंडो दिख रही है आपको?
यस मैम
ओके, चलिए ठीक है, मैं आपको और थोड़ा सा एक्सप्लेन करना चाहूंगा। तो आई होप दैट कि आप लोगों को जो वर्चुअल एक्सपेरिमेंट है उसकी नॉलेज थोड़ी बहुत हो गई है। सो आई एम गोइंग टू द एक्सपेरिमेंट व्हिच वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दैट डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ ग्रेटिंग। सो दिस इज द डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ ग्रेटिंग। आई थिंक यू हैव ऑलरेडी नो अबाउट दैट। वी हैव ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू अबाउट दैट थ्योरी पार्ट। दिस इज द प्रोसीजर पार्ट। And so we are going towards directly the simulation part. Okay, first we have to log in as here. I am logging in. So this is the spectrometer basically. Okay, I have already told you this is the spectrometer and this is the colliometer and this one is the telescope. We have two scales. This is vernier one and vernier two scale. This is the prism table and this is the grating holder. I have already told you about that. Okay. So for doing this type of experiment in simulation process, first you have to focus the telescope in the procedure. Okay. So here's the knob. We can change it, and you are saying basically you are adjusting to a long distance object. So we are focusing it. As we focus it, so see that now the long distance object is clearly visible. And if this is not visible, this startup window is not pop up. If it is visible, then it is pop up. So we can, if it is not visible, see here, it is not pop up. So move it, this cursor, and when this image is clearly visible, then click it here. Okay, so this will give the image of a telescope. Okay, here it is a source, this one is colliometer, this is the telescope, these two are the vernier scales, this one is vernier one and this one is vernier two. So see here, first we will just switch on the light. Just we have switch on the light, and you see this, there is a slit. You can change the slit focus and slit width from here. See here, I am moving the cursor. The slit focusing is changing. Again, we can change the slit width. We are changing the slit width. Now the slit width is changing. So with this help, we can change the slit width, but we have to maintain a very small slit width. We have to focus this properly. We have to make slit width very narrow. Okay. So this, now the slit width is okay, and I have already talked about this crossfire. This is the crossfire in this telescope. So we have to move this cross, this slit towards this crossfire. This is the place grating. If we click it, the grating will be mounted here. See here. If we remove it, there is no grating. If we place the grating, we can place the grating here. Now we can move or to change the angle of this telescope. This is the telescope. We can move it towards the right side or towards the left side. Okay, see here. We can move it left side or right side, both the side with the help of this. Again, we can change the grating table also with the help of this. This. Here, we can also move this vernier table. This is the vernier table. We can also move it. See here, we can move the vernier table also. Okay, So by this, you can do many things. Suppose if we remove the grating, we'll get, and we move the telescope, so we are getting only the central light or white light. But and we have to put this in the center of this crosswire. Now, if we're putting the grating in the table, so if we are putting the grating in the table, then we have to do all the adjustment. And if we move this telescope towards the left side and right side, okay, we are moving the telescope towards the left side. See, we are getting the Wittgenstein pattern. And again, if we are moving to the right side, again we are getting the Wittgenstein pattern. So both the central, this one is the central maximum white, and both we are getting the right side first order maximum and the left side first order maximum. And just see here, this is the zoom section. If you are taking the reading, you can take the reading from here. See, suppose we have to fix that here, and I have already told you that there are main scale and vernier scale. The lower part is the main scale, then the upper part is vernier scale, and in this scale there are from 0 to 30 degrees. Okay, so you have to calculate first its least count, which I have already told you that how to calculate the least count. Then you have to calculate that which zero point of main vernier scale is coinciding with the main scale, that will give you the main scale reading. And then which part of the vernier scale is exactly matching with the vernier scale, that will give you the value of main vernier scale. Then we'll multiply the vernier scale to the least count and we'll get the value of total reading. So by this you can do the experiment using the procedure. You have different types of knobs here. You can rotate them, you can remove the grating, you can place the grating, you can change each and every angle, you can change the telescope, grating table, this one is the grating table, you can change this vernier table, you can adjust this fine adjustment or the telescope, you can focus it, you can zoom it properly, reading, and then you have to place the reading here. Okay, just see, first you are considering the green color, then you have to calculate the grating element, which I have already told you. Then order, you are mostly you are taking the first order. Then this one, suppose you are considering this is vernier one and this is vernier two, then for the left side you have to take the reading of vernier one and vernier two. Then you have to move this telescope to the right side and you have to take the reading vernier 1 and vernier 2 again, and you have to put it here. So for vernier 1, left and right. For vernier 2, left and right. Then calculate the value of theta, then 2 theta, then theta. And then I have already told you the formula. Then put the value of 2 theta for different colors and you will get the value of lambda. And then finally compare these values with the standard one which you have known, and then you can calculate the percentage error and get that how you can finding it.